If you take a look at the nighttime map of your country, most probably the map will look brightly lit with electric lights. But when you look at the Korean Peninsula, you notice something strange. On one side, you see South Korea, which is brightly lit. But on the other side, there is North Korea, which is almost pitch black, except a handful of dimly lit spots, the biggest of which is, predictably, Pyongyang. While North Korea's neighbors, South Korea, Japan, and China, are brightly lit, why is North Korea completely dark? Well, to put it simply, North Korea doesn't have enough electricity to keep its lights on at night. Strangely, just 30 to 40 years ago, North Korea used to have one of the most developed electricity networks in the entirety of Asia. To begin with, the Korean Peninsula used to be under the Japanese colonial occupation until 1945. The Japanese emphasized on developing Northern Korea as an industrial hub, while Southern Korea was preferred for agriculture. The Japanese built a number of large and powerful hydroelectric plants on the Yalu River in the 1930s and 1940s. Among those hydroelectric plants, Supong hydroelectric plant was the largest of its kind in Asia at that time. Compared to Southern Korea, Northern Korea had so many hydroelectric plants that it produced nearly 85% of all electricity in Korea. In fact, immediately after the liberation of Korean Peninsula from the Japanese Empire in 1945, North Korea started selling electricity to South Korea. At that point, electric development was so rapid and intense in North Korea, it demanded payment for electricity from South Korea in electric equipment and refused to accept payment in US dollars or other goods. When South Korea didn't pay in electric equipment, North Korea eventually stopped selling electricity to South Korea in 1948. In 1950, amid the Korean War, most of North Korea's electric power networks suffered massive damages due to US aerial bombardment. And because of those damages, most of North Korea's hydroelectric plants had to be shut down. North Korea's industry and agriculture, which were heavily dependent on electricity, got severely hit. With the end of the Korean War in 1953, the North Korean regime started rebuilding and repairing the damaged hydroelectric plants and electric power networks. The Soviet Union was quick to provide North Korea with necessary equipment like electric turbines, turbine generators, boilers, along with skilled specialists to assist in rebuilding and repairing. Soon, North Korea was able to rebuild its electric power networks, and electricity became a symbol of North Korean power. The North Korean regime even put the design of a grand hydroelectric plant in its national emblem. Until 1960, 100% of North Korea's electricity came from hydroelectric plants. Because of such over-dependency on hydroelectricity, North Korea had to face electricity shortages during periods of droughts. And for the first time in 1960, North Korea started building thermal power plants and produced electricity from coal. In 1973, North Korea's per capita electricity consumption was far greater compared to South Korea. By 1983, per capita electricity consumption in the two countries was nearly the same at about 1,100 kWh per year. As you can see in this graph, while per capita electricity consumption in the South Korea grew by 53% to reach 2,370 kWh, North Korea's per capita electricity consumption grew by just 11% to reach 1,240 kWh. By 2018, while South Korea's per capita electricity consumption increased to 10,860 kWh, North Korea's per capita electricity consumption fell down to 540 kWh. The year 1991 was a turning point for North Korea's economy, especially the electricity sector. Aid and assistance from the Soviet Union in the form of electric equipment and skilled specialists suddenly stopped coming with the dissolution of Soviet Union in 1991. And with that, the regular functioning of North Korea's hydroelectric plants got severely hit. Moreover, North Korea used to import subsidized oil and petroleum products from the Soviet Union and China at below market prices. But with the dissolution of Soviet Union and the end of Cold War, those deals suddenly ended and North Korea's oil consumption dropped drastically from 76,000 barrels per day in 1991 to around 15,000 barrels per day in 2017. With the lack of availability of oil, North Korea's oil-fired power plants got severely hit. Since 1991, North Korea continues to face acute shortages of electricity. In 2016, only 27% of North Korea's population had access to electricity, in stark contrast to its neighbor South Korea, where 100% of population had access to electricity. Regular blackouts for hours are not just common for rural residents, even residents in North Korea's capital, Pyongyang, where only supreme leaders' loyalists live, also face frequent blackouts. The situation is so terrible, residents often hesitate to live in high-rise apartment buildings, fearing dozens of flights of stairs during power outages. Under such acute shortage of power, the regime rations power according to priority. Power is supplied first and foremost to Kim Il-sung and Kim Jong-il idolization sites, then to munition factories, military bases, essential government organizations like the party or intelligence bodies. Since the state cares for the status of its former leaders more than the country's common citizens, citizens are often left to their fates to rent electricity on their own. Earlier, North Koreans used to keep mini generators in their households, usually powered by a small internal combustion engine, but sometimes by owners pushing bicycle-like pedals to produce electricity. Such mini generators used to charge large batteries which supplied electricity to TV sets, lamps, and other simple devices. But in the last 4 to 5 years, with the arrival of readily available and cheap Chinese-made solar panels, residents in North Korea now prefer solar panels over mini generators. Solar panels are so coveted nowadays, North Koreans consider them a must-have item. Almost every household has one panel at least. But basic solar panels can only power lighting and devices that require less electricity, such as televisions. But far more energy is needed to run appliances such as washing machines or refrigerators or air conditioners. And to run such energy-intensive appliances, affluent North Korean families access the electricity in a more expensive but eventually the most efficient way. As we have discussed earlier, North Korean regime rations power according to priority. So, in the period of power shortages, it is households which are switched off first, followed by non-military factories and less important institutions. If the situation is extremely serious, then military bases, headquarters of police, and major state institutions are switched off as well. That's why many well-connected and rich North Koreans get their houses connected by a privately laid cable linked to the supply of one of the powerful institutions. For example, a cluster of rich people's houses can be supplied by one cable connected to, say, a military base or a local party office. Such an arrangement is illegal and bribes have to be paid. But the abundance and steady supply of electricity is worth all the trouble. In 2018, 12% of North Korea's electricity came from coal-fired power plants, 5% from oil-fired power plants, a mere 0.1% from solar power plants, and the rest, 82.9% from hydroelectric power plants. Due to such over-dependency on hydroelectricity, electricity situation worsens in cold winters when rivers freeze. Apart from that, most of the hydroelectric plants in North Korea are of the run-of-river variety, which means that their output is more subject to variations in the stream flow than plants that rely on reservoirs with greater water storage. Therefore, the electricity situation also gets worse in droughts. Although North Korea often stays in news for its nuclear weapons, it currently has no facilities to generate electricity from nuclear energy. Strangely, North Korea is a net exporter of electricity despite having severe shortage of power for its own use. North Korea generates a major share of revenue by exporting iron ore and coal. But United Nations sanctions currently ban North Korea from exporting coal, steel, iron ore, food and textiles, as well as prohibiting the practice of sending laborers overseas to earn funds for the regime. Fortunately, export of electricity is exempted from sanctions, leaving North Korea with no other option but to sell its electricity that the country so desperately needs. With a relatively few exceptions, the electric power infrastructure in North Korea was installed prior to 1990 with the aid and assistance of the Soviet Union, with some infrastructure, especially large hydroelectric power plants dating back to the period of Japanese colonial occupation in the 1920s and 1930s. With the lack of new, efficient, updated technology and machinery, almost all North Korea power plants run at half capacity. Moreover, electricity transmission and distribution losses are also quite high in North Korea. Although North Korea government's official figures suggest only 16% T&D losses, many independent studies claim that the T&D losses to be as high as 50%. If you liked this video, then hit the like button and consider subscribing to Very Well Informed.